Good morning, my name is Christian and I am going to talk about our work precise temporal P300 detection in brain-computer interface EEG signals using a long short-term memory. This work has been done in collaboration with Vinicio Changoluisa from Universidad Politécnica Salesiana in Ecuador and with Francisco de Borja Rodríguez and Luis Lago-Fernández. This work has been carried out at Universidad Autónoma de Madrid in Spain. First, it is important to introduce brain-computer interfaces, or BCIs. It is a technology that allows us to transform neural activity into external commands, so we can interact with the outside world just by using these interfaces. The brain activity is recorded and then it is processed to generate some output. Event-related potential detection, or ERP detection, is one of the ways to implement BCIs. An ERP is a stereotyped brain response to a specific sensory, cognitive, or motor event, and it can be carried out in electroencephalography signals, or EEG. An ERP always presents positive or negative voltage deflections. Indeed, we can recognize them. These deflections appear with a certain latency after a stimulus is presented. One of the most used ERPs in BCIs is the P300. It stands out for its positive deflection that happens with a latency of around 300 milliseconds after the stimulus presentation. I show you in the figure an example of the signal that we expect to find. You can see that the P300 response is easy to recognize. However, it is just an example on average. The real signals are quite noisy, and it is not the only problem. Of course, the latency of the signals varies over a huge range. It depends on several factors of the subject, for example, if he is tired at the trial, or he is distracted, or whatever. The stimulus itself can also affect, and there is also a large variability between different users. We call intervariability to these differences between users, and intravariability to the variability within the same user. It is important to mention that the intravariability is not only about the timing of the ERP, but also the different electrodes in the EEG. At different times of the trial, the brain response can appear at different electrodes. The temporal and spatial structures are variable. Spatial patterns used to appear in the posterior region of the brain, but they also appear in the central and frontal regions. Its temporal structure also changes from one trial to another, affecting its amplitude and latency. Therefore, identifying the variability can improve the precision and also the speed of communication of BCIs. So, let's talk about the dataset. We use the Hoffman dataset, which follows a common way of generating P300 in the context of BCIs, the well-known oddball paradigm. Here, a set of stimuli of two categories, target and non-target, are presented to the subject, and our task is to classify when the target is presented. When the subject sees the target, a P300 should appear. The dataset contains EEG signals corresponding to the answer of 8 users to random image sequences of 6 different images with an interstimulus interval of 400 milliseconds. Each flash of an image lasted for 100 milliseconds, and in the last 300 milliseconds, user waits for the next image. The EEG signals in the dataset were recorded from 32 electrodes at the standard positions of the 1020 international system. However, we propose to vary the standard procedure in the preprocessing phase. The standard approach consists of extracting a 1 second window after each stimulus, and then each window is tagged as target or non-target. However, because of the interstimulus interval of 400 milliseconds, as I want to show in the figure, the signals in the dataset are overlapped. The last 600 milliseconds from the first window are shared with the following one. Creating 1 second windows is a good strategy when we don't use temporal series models, but this causes some troubles when we train recurrent neural networks. So, our preprocessing is much simpler. We directly use the continuous signal to avoid the overlapping. However, now the model must learn to predict something in a continuous way at each sample. And now, the question is, how can we define the prediction at a sample level? In the figure, I show an example of the P300 latency versus the age of the subjects. Here, we can directly see the intervariability between subjects, so we need to keep it in mind. So, to define the classes at each sample, we must consider that we don't know exactly where the P300 happens because of the variability. Therefore, we add two additional hyperparameters in the dataset generation, offset and window size. The offset is the start time of the P300 after the image presentation, and window size is the event duration. Now, look at the following plot. Here you have an example of adding some offset, where the orange plot is shifted to the right, and the bottom plot is an example where we change the window size, making it bigger. In this figure, we can also observe that the target stimulus is the image 2. Every time the pink plot appears in the input, the output target is true. So, the output just depends on the offset and the window size. The standard approaches to solve this problem are based on discriminant analysis. Hoffman uses the Bayesian Linear Discriminant Analysis and is the one with which we want to compare our results. There exist some other works that are based on retrieve and process the spatial information of the electrodes by using two-dimensional convolutional neural networks. However, there are very few works based on the processing of temporal information. So, we propose to use a long short-term memory network to process the EEG as a time series. An interesting point when using a recurrent neural network is that we can approach time series processing in two different ways. The many-to-one strategy allows us to process the full signal and then to give just a prediction. On the other hand, the many-to-many strategy allows us to predict the output at each time step. With the offset and window size, we can follow the many-to-many strategy. However, to compare this model with the Bayesian linear discriminant analysis, we need to transform a many-to-many output into just one prediction. The standard test, the followed one when we use the BLDA, consists of processing the 1 second window all at once, and then the model gives the prediction. However, the recurrent test needs to transform all the many predictions into just one. The test consists of predicting the 1 second window at each time step, and then get the maximum value of the small window defined by the offset and the window size. This way, we can compare both models. In summary, we use the many-to-many strategy to train the model at a sample level, but to compare with the Bayesian linear discriminant analysis, we test the model at a trial level. Now, I am going to describe the experiments. The dataset has the recorded EEG signals from 8 different users, and each user has passed the trial in 4 different sessions. So, we have 4 subsets per user. To validate the results, we apply a k-fold cross-validation test per user, with k equal to 4. This k is, of course, because there are 4 sessions per user. At each fold, 3 sessions will be used for training, and the last is for the test. The metric that we use is balanced accuracy. But why not to use standard accuracy? Because the dataset is imbalanced. It has 5 non-target images versus 1 target image. So we want to avoid a model that predicts, for example, 83% of accuracy just by predicting the priori. Now, I begin with the results. First of all, with our experiments, we can extract some temporal information about the signal just by looking at the obtained score with some offset and window size. With this, we can directly analyze a single user and its intravariability between sessions, and also we can compare the 8 different users and their intervariability. Finally, it is also important to mention that we improve the performance obtained by the Hoffman's model, the Bayesian linear discriminant analysis, which is also a good point. Before I start, I would like to highlight that a higher offset doesn't mean that the only valid information is at this point. Think that we are processing a time series, so the model can use all the previous signals to predict the final decision at any time. This is the key to understand why a recurrent model performs better. For example, if we get the best accuracy at 600 milliseconds, it doesn't mean that only the sample at 600 milliseconds has the full information, but that the previous signal from 0 to 600 has determined the current state in the LSTM, and thus, at 600 milliseconds it can give the best prediction. Now, let's go with the figure. Here, I am showing a color map of the balanced accuracy obtained with different offset and window size values. These results are obtained from the user 1 and its 4 different test sessions in the cross-validation. Observe that test session 1, 2, and 4 may have some similarities. The best setting seems to have an offset around 300 milliseconds, with some variance, and with a window size of 100. This is just amazing, because it is telling us that really there is a P300 ERP, and the network is just learning to recognize it. However, something happens with the third test session. This time, the best offset seems to be at 600 milliseconds and with higher window size. It is demonstrating that the network is able to learn this intra-variability and adapt to it. What does really happen to the user in this session? We don't really know, but the network doesn't care and it is still learning. Now, I show you the intervariability between users. First of all, the plot for each user is the result of the cross-validation test for each offset and window size, which is the average of the four plots we have seen before. In these pictures, you can observe that there exists a huge intervariability between the 8 users. Users have different offset values, some of them around 300 milliseconds, and also have different window size values. With these plots, we can directly understand what the network is doing internally, but we do understand where is the temporal information in the EEG signals. And what about the performance? Our methodology with the LSTM has a better balance accuracy, which is not exceptional, but is also a good point. The Hoffman model, the Bayesian Linear Discriminant Analysis, reaches a 73% of accuracy, while our LSTM reaches a 76% of accuracy. I would like to mention that, even if the performances are similar, our methodology has two significant differences. First, now the model gives a real-time evaluation, sample by sample, when a P300 happens. In other words, this approach provides us the precise temporal information we were looking for. Second, our approach brings us the possibility of analyzing both the intra and inter variability of P300. In conclusion, in our work we have presented a new methodology in P300 based BCI prediction using a long short-term memory network. With this network, we can analyze the input signal continuously in a sample level prediction instead of the standard trial level predictions. Our results demonstrate that the LSTM network can extract the appropriate information from the input signals by learning the temporal dependencies to give the prediction in real time. And we also show that the LSTM can find that some variability exists among different sessions in the same user. Besides, we show that our methodology has a good performance compared with the work by Hoffman. This new methodology opens the way to a study of the EEG signals in ERP-based BCIs that will improve the information transfer rate, which is still a pending challenge for BCIs. Also, sample-level prediction allows real-time monitoring of the EEG signal generation, and also it can help us to locate the temporal information related to a target stimulus. To finish with the presentation, I would like to introduce you to our current work. We are working on the interpretability of the model in this task. I can say that we are working on extracting which are the relevant electrodes, that is, which are the electrodes where the important temporal information is flowing. I think that looking for the interpretability could be the way to improve the ERP-based BCIs. Thank you for your attention.